Today we've got one of Glasgow's number one, actually let's say one of the UK's number one watch sellers here. You know, something that I love is watches. If you follow me on Instagram, you know I love sharing stuff, looking at the new releases, but it's not often I get to sit down with people who work with such amazing clients and such amazing pieces as well. My name is Richard Dixon, welcome to the Yes Podcast, and we'll talk all things business, entrepreneurship, life. We bring in successful young people to talk about their stories and show you how you can actually go out and replicate something similar for yourself. You all know me, it's the first time doing a podcast in a wee while. Yeah, I'm a lazy bastard, I fell off and was doing other things for a little bit. But we're back with an absolutely amazing episode. I wanted to make sure that the guest we got today was someone that was going to blow your minds. I know when I first started reading stuff about watches and, you know, I'd never owned a watch. My first watch was a Ben Sherman, by the way, for anybody wondering, right? I didn't know anything about watches. And when you start finding out the prices and all the different things about the market, it's absolutely exceptional. And there's no one better, especially in the city of Glasgow, for me to share this episode with than Ryan Morgan from Glasgow Watch Co. So, Ryan, first time on a podcast.
I know, mate. First time. Man.
So, how's it feel? The bright lights, not freaking...
Sweating a wee bit, mate. It's sweating a wee bit. My God. Thanks for having us on anyway.
Thank you for coming along, mate. We've known each other for a few years now. It was originally because you trained with Reese and stuff at the Grip House, wasn't
it? Grip House, aye, mate. I've done like the 5-week course with Dean and Reese. Yeah. Done that, and we actually got put as partners because I didn't have any pals.
Oh, really? Did you? I don't remember.
That was ages ago, mate. That must have been...
2017? 2016?
Aye, probably.
Round about then.
I don't think you were doing any profit at the time when you were still a...
Were you selling watches?
No, mate.
I wasn't doing what I'm doing now.
I was a welder.
Is that what you done?
That's when I came out of school, mate. I went and done an apprenticeship. 5 or 6 years I done welding, mate. Went down south to Birmingham, done a year in Birmingham, learned how to weld. And then went on the nuclear power stations in the UK.
Oh, shit. My dad worked at Sellafield.
Aye, so that's the mega one. That's where all the nuclear fuel is.
Hinkley Point or
something. Aye, I've been down there, mate. That was... I didn't like it, mate. You're away from home too often.
Yeah.
Good money, but you were away for 6 weeks at a time and that. Mate.
And being around that radio, I've been to Chernobyl, mate. I'm really keen on the radiation.
That's
mate.
Nuts, mate. I saw that.
It's crazy, mate. It's crazy.
But it's some of the things they do in that nuclear power station, it's no right. Like, it's... You wouldn't think...
Selling watches is better.
Selling watches is definitely better, mate. A bit more stressful selling watches, actually.
Well, see, the thing is, it's your average value of your... item, you know, like when you, especially just being an entrepreneur, never mind being an employee somewhere that's like danger money doing stuff, but when you're running your own thing and you're dealing with, I mean, what is it you've got on today? Let us know what that is.
Skeleton AP.
What do those come in at?
About 130,000.
Right, so if you're tripping mega fall, you're tripping fall.
No, I know, that's gone, mate, I know. But I love the job, mate, honestly, like, it's, I didn't expect to be doing it. It's weird, actually, like, the other day on Facebook, the pop-ups came up.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, my family been into jewellery for
years. It's more like ring-making. So by the way, I'm grabbing the notes for the episode just in case I can text.
Yeah, he's never touched watches. Like, he always does gold and diamonds, he does. But a Facebook memory came up and it was like, I must have been second or third year in school. And I've kind of always had this thing that even when I was that age, like, I needed to earn money. Like, it's always kind of been in my mind. Through my dad, probably, but it popped up. It was like a police watch that I was selling on, policing an ice watch that popped up. I was selling on Facebook for like £100 or something at the time that I would probably got off my dad because that was the watches he had installed and I was just selling them on Facebook, but they never sold. Now I'm selling 130 gram watches, mate.
So. And they're flying probably.
It's mental, mate. Honestly, it's crazy. Like, when I started, I didn't realise the wealth in Glasgow. Like, it's mega.
Mate,
you know yourself with property and all that. Like, there's mega wealth in Glasgow for some people.
It's funny, mate. I've been saying this recently, right? And I don't know if it's because when you start having nice things, you recognise nice things more, right? So you've got an M4 Compa. That's what you've got, right?
You get rid of it now because Wayne's coming.
Oh, yeah. You've got
I need to go and get a Kia or something. So if any Kia dealers are in the podcast, let us know.
Libby's got a Kia. One of the admin managers got a Kia. But, I don't know if they were already there and I just wasn't looking for them. See, when I got like even an A45 years ago, an A45, then I started noticing more AMGs. Then I got an I8 and then a CI8's everywhere. Now, mate, see if you sit like all the wee car spotters in Glasgow and stuff, you sit at Ingram Street or you sit at where the Hilton is coming out of the motorway. On any Saturday, you're going to see every luxury car. Mine is your hypercars, right? But mate, the carbon exposed Senna that's coming out of Glasgow just now.
Is there?
£1.6 million Senna.
I wonder. Who's got that?
It's a guy from down south. He works in Aberdeen. Because I was in McLaren the other day, I was asking about him. Didn't tell me who it was. We're like, guy lives up in Aberdeen. That car
how much
stays at house. This carbon exposed Senna, 1.5, 1.6 million, full spec.
Tell him I'm selling watches if he wants it.
Aye, come down, buy one. But Aye, there is more money in Glasgow.
Mate, it's mental. I think it's probably what you said, like, because we weren't used to it, we were doing trades and that before, but now you're sort of into people that have got that sort of wealth, you do realise it more now, but yeah, Glasgow's sure. nuts, like, some mega money in Glasgow, people with serious wealth, mate, which is good.
What you do with Glasgow Watch Co, is that your first business?
No, I've had loads of wee shit business.
Oh, really? Have you? I wanted to ask you this, mate, because I wasn't sure.
We'll start off when I was in school, mate. I remember a boy, Sandro, me and him started, bought Iron Brew and that for Co-op. I know everyone says this, but we generally done it. Bought Iron Brew, like the big packs, brought them in, sold them at a locker. We ended up getting caught and fucked for it. And then after, during school, I think maybe sixth year, I started like a clothing brand. And quite a funny story, me and this boy put like, don't know, the time to on a quid to buy like 100 t-shirts that came from Pakistan with like a logo on them, and they came, and mate, I wouldn't even get it to my dog. It was the worst quality ever, man. Ended up just looking at him going, nah, we'll just shut this. So that failed, and then no long ago, maybe 3 or 4 years ago, I started selling jewellery, just started my own business page selling jewellery.
You made the bracelet for Jess.
I started that. That was all right, it wasn't great. And then again, I just sort of gave up on it. And then the watch thing came, and it just sort of took off, mate. So there was failed ones before the watch one done, all right. But there was several failed ones.
You take your lumps or something.
Mate, you just need to keep going, mate. Keep trying and keep going, mate. That's I always knew like one of these work. Just keep going until one of them works. And then, to be fair, the watch one did work. So.
The other ones are probably cheaper mistakes as well. Like, see if you lose 400 quid on some t-shirts from Pakistan, you learn a great lesson for a very small cost.
Aye, exactly. I'm glad that happened when I was young. But mate, even in this game now, like, I'm still making mistakes, mate. Every day, like, we'll buy watches that we think at the time are a good price, and then realise no, quite a good price.
Yeah.
And then you need to get rid of them for like a grand loss to just to get your money back, buy something else. But mate, that's just watch dealing. Like, you're always gonna. Maybe the same with property or sale, there's always going to be mistakes you make.
Mm, for sure.
And you learn from it.
What is it that made you stick on watches, right? Because nowadays, you'll be like me, you're a young, successful guy, and as you get more successful, your circle changes, you meet other young, successful people, right? And a lot of people our age, under 30s, they are often new money, often what I call e-money. Crypto guys, traders, e-commerce, all that kind of stuff, online coaches, stuff like that, right? What do you think drew you towards something like watches? Was it personal interest that you seen could make money? Was it opportunity? No. What? Why was watches? Because you could have done anything. You could have done crypto.
I know. Done that. We just fell in it. So my business partner, I'll give him a wee shout out. He sold watches for about 7 years before me, but like doing it as a hobby, like he just loved watches. I wasn't into watches at all, to be fair. Never wore a watch. Kind of hated them.
Oh, really?
But then I saw that there was a wee bit of money to be made in his family. So I started bringing him some deals that people were asking me for watches. Mm. And then he was going to get them. I'm making like 50 quid on like a 7 grand Rolex and that. Like really, really low margins, mate. But I just liked doing it, bringing him the deals and that. And then, mate, we sort of realised, fuck man, there is a bit of money to be on this. And I'm money driven, like it doesn't matter what I sell. And then watches just became part of my life, like just buying and selling. And to be fair, I didn't like watches before. Now my life is all watches, mate, watches and cars, mate. But I just fell into it, mate. It's sort of luck. This was pre-COVID when watches weren't what they were now. And there wasn't really many people in Glasgow doing it. So a bit of luck was involved in it. But we sort of, that's how we fell into it. It was weird.
What was your moment where it went from, this is a nice little thing I'm doing, I'm making some extra money, to, wait a second, it's time to cut everything else off and focus completely on this?
When one of our bank accounts got shut. We were just doing it through our own bank, just buying and selling.
And your personal account?
Aye. So one of our accounts got shut down, and then that's when we realised, fuck, like, we need to do this properly. Like, we need to start a business, get a logo, do all this sort of stuff. That was the point where we need to do this properly and stuff like that. But banking get shut down.
Did you manage to recover your money?
Got everything sorted and that. They were just like, why is this happening? Like, it was just irregular transactions, because like, we had like one watch and like 10, 15 grand at the time. So like, the bank were obviously like,
why is this
on your account? It was going in and out, and then that's when we said, like, we've started up a company, and that's how we started it. Just got the name and company's house and all that sort of stuff. So that's how it sort of started.
Can you adjust lights, Gary? Are we okay?
No, that's all good.
Is it?
even though I've just pointed it out on camera.
Oh, like, we have taken big losses on watches, mate. I think the biggest one we've taken is probably 20 grand. 20 grand loss on a watch, mate. Aye, so...
How did that feel?
So one, mate, but to be fair, my dad was the one that actually said to me, like, you just need to just fucking get out your head. Like, it's done, it's over. You just need to think about how you get that back and then get your money back and then start earning for that. So, to be fair, he kind of got it. Now, he don't think of it as a 20 grand loss. Think of it as you've got your money back in your pot and then you build up your pot again. So, I would put it down to him. Him and my uncle, actually, that they're quite sensible like that. And that's why I think we've done well, is because they've been there to guide us. So it's no just me, like, I'm not going to take all the credit because I can't. Uh-huh. Me and Mark have done really well, like, we have done well, but they've been there in the background, sort of mentoring us, and I think that's been good for us as well. So
makes a big difference. I mean,
definitely, mate.
I always talk about mentorship, and, like, I think that's why I got faster results having someone like Paul. And like,
that's networking as well. Like, you've managed to network with Paul, and he's sort of, I can imagine he's probably taught you some things. And
for sure.
For my dad and my uncle, they've told us mistakes they made in business to try and stop us from making them. Exactly. I mean, I probably went and made those mistakes anyway, but it's good to have him there to sort of, like, just tell you, don't do that, do that, blah, blah, blah. So it's good, mate.
See, nowadays, watches are, there's such amazing content online, right? Good, and I think people who would have never known or found watches interesting, because really, let's be honest, watches, apart from how they look, are quite boring. I don't know how the movements work, nor do I
get it.
I don't care, right? You fix one, right? I hope you do. But what'd you call it? I don't know or understand any of that stuff, nor do I find that interesting. I want to know what the brand is, how much it costs, how rare it is, that kind of
stuff. I think
stuff,
most
right?
people like that as well, mate. That's the sort of glorious sight of watches. Like, you can buy one and it can go up so much money and stuff like that. Like, there is an investment side to it, but I think you do get quite a lot of watch nerds that are into, like, the movements and stuff.
Yeah.
Personally, me, I'm not into that. My business partner, he is a watch nerd. He's into, like, see, like, that watch there. He's into, like, the movement, what the movement's like and stuff.
Would he have the balls to open the case back on it?
Probably not. He'll tell you everything about it. Like, he'll tell you all the codes and blah, 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 the movement and stuff. He'll tell you when it was released, all this shit, but he's no...
Do you know what I've found in my experience, right? And... I've not had a huge array of watches. I've had some nice watches, right? And when I wear a watch, people maybe ask you a question. What type of watch is that? Oh, it's a Skydweller. It's this, it's that. Aye, cool. See the people who want to talk about movements, want to talk about their collection and how this is that. This, I think it's always people where, I don't want to say shite watches, because what you like is what you like, right? But everyone I see online, see if you go to, like, Reddit, like r/watch or whatever, right? All the people are like, oh, this is a some French thing this long, this blues, is a movement.
You
and
get
it's,
some people
it's
that are...
It's made in a factory 7 nautical miles away from Rolex and all that. And it's like a £200 watch.
It just shows you, like, the popularity. Like, people are so invested in them. Even the smaller watches, tags and all that, people, like... do their research and all that and get proper invested in it. So I think that it's weird how popular watches have become in the last 5 years. Like, it's mental. Like, investment wise as well, I remember, I think our first watch we bought was a Hulk. Samarna Hulk. I think maybe 5 years ago or something. And it was like £6,000. And I think we sold one last week for £16,000. So people are wearing them for like 5-6 years and getting £10,000 profit out of them. I know.
The fuck? I know, Jesus Christ.
But aye, it's mental, man. It's just the watch game. Have you ever watched that movie Uncut Gems with Adam Sandler?
Yes, it's amazing, life, mate. It's amazing.
Just 100 miles an hour at all times, mate. Like, balancing things, moving money. A lot of people don't pay on time, you're chasing.
But you don't get, like, leathered by the mafia.
No, I don't get shot in the end, so... Exactly, so it's weird, like, it's class, but I love waking up and going to sell watches,
mate. You know that Uncut Gems, right? That's maybe, what, 4 or 5 years old now?
Yeah.
Mate, I watched it first time last week.
Did you?
By chance, right? Because I watched that Hustle with Adam Sandler. He's the basketball scout. That's one of the best films I've ever seen. And I was just in an Adam Sandler but no Happy Gilmore mood. I seen that Uncut Gems. And do you know what I found was so funny? That Tracks NYC's in it.
Oh, the watch dealer?
Yeah.
Mate, I didn't even know it. I don't know who he is, but I didn't even know.
Tracks NYC's in it. He's like his employee in the shop with the chains on and all that.
No way.
Tracks NYC, yeah. See, with all the hype around watches and obviously you... admittedly, no being interested in watches, and now at a point where you love it, right? you'll have seen the affordable, the expensive, the weird, the wonderful, everything, right? If I can give you a voucher right now, it was just a one watch voucher, and don't make it just the most expensive for the sake of it, right? But if you could have one watch in your hand, it's yours, what would you use that voucher on?
Probably, I know you said not expensive, but just because I'm so invested in golf right now, I've taken over my life, golf, I love it. But I think Bubba, Richard Mills, Bubba Watson.
Oh, they're sick.
That is mega. He was wearing it at the Masters, actually.
I think it's super light.
It's carbon fibre. But mate, honestly, it's cool. It's got like a white case with pink through it. You'd love it. It's something stand out, man. It's unreal.
How much are those?
2.2 million. So you need to use a big voucher, mate. they're mega. Like, I think there's only 52 of them in the world or something.
Oh wow!
So they're extremely rare. But mate, I've sold one Richard Mille, and
I remember that
RM10, mate. They're not for everyone. Like, there's a lot of hate about Richard Mille's, but mate, there's just
based on what the design or
aye, they're chunky, mate. They're matte, like, yep. Like a Ben 10 watch. Remember I had that Ben 10 watch, you're a wee guy? Like, it's like that. It's chunky. You know you're wearing it. It's like a brick. But, mate, I think just the watch side of it, I think I love that watch, mate. It's stunning. I've never seen one in the flesh. I'd love to. And if I was to get a voucher, if I wanted to be that, I think.
On the opposite side, right, because I find with guys who know the watch, especially watch dealers, like, if they like something, they love it.
Yeah.
They hate something, they... No one's always agnostic about everything.
There's a lot of watches that I hate.
What do you think is like the worst watch you can buy? Ugliest, most despicable piece of shit?
Jacob & Co.
Really?
Hey, mate. No. I don't see the hype around Jacob & Co. Like, I know you've got, he's marketed amazing. Like, he's got Conor McGregor wearing all the stuff, and he's made Cristiano Ronaldo ones and that. He's, the brand have done amazing, but
and did they do that Bugatti watch that Tate has?
Yeah, Bugatti watch, mate. That's nuts. That's crazy. That but mate, I just don't get them, mate. Like, I don't.
Surely the technology, you know, that's incredible.
It's cool, mate. But I don't know. I don't like it. Don't know. Just don't like it. Like, I've seen the what's the one?
Casino.
It's got the on it. Like, do you think it's too much in a watch? I know I'm saying I like Richard Mills and that, but like that, there's too much going on in it. I don't know, man.
Mate, straight away when I first seen that watch, because I love Vegas.
Vegas
is amazing,
like,
right? Have you ever been to Vegas?
Aye, I was my dad's 50.
It's class. It's so good. Right? So I love, like, I don't gamble when I'm here, but when I'm in Vegas, I'll play poker tournaments, I'll do this and that, because you just have fun, right? And I was just thinking that, like, if I was sitting with that watch on and us three are in here, me, you and Gary, I'd be like, right, stick a pound on a number, pound on a, and I would just sit all day, like, I would not be able to concentrate.
Aye, it's mega, like, the engineering behind it's incredible. I don't know how they've done it, but I just don't like the watch to wear, mate. I think it's just for celebrities, it's no for, like, the normal punter.
What would you say, in terms of a watch that's accessible for most people? What would you say is that perfect?
See, tags, I love tags.
Yeah?
Mate, I got my tag for my 18th birthday, mate. I love them, I think they're most affordable, nicest watches you can get, mate. I love all tags, mate. Don't really get asked a lot for tags, but I'd like to start selling more of them. There's not mega money in tags, because you can walk into the shop and get them, but I think maybe the fact I got one when I was 18 and I had it on for years.
I've never had one. I don't actually.
They're just nice watches. Nice built, some good designs and stuff on them, and they're pretty affordable. If you want to buy your first watch, you should always go with a tag.
Yeah.
Yeah. Cool, mate.
Do you know what I love, mate? I love the G-Shocks, mate.
Colourful ones, see the ones that got the colour around it?
Unbelievable.
I've never seen them in the flesh, I've seen them on Insta and that, mate, but they're practical.
What's it called? Cassie Oaks? That's what it is, because the shape,
is
it? I guess it's like
it's
similar to that.
I've seen them, mate, they do look cool actually, but I don't know the prices or anything on them.
100 quid.
Oh, they that cheap?
Well, the ones I have, I've got a white one and a grey one.
Aye, they are cool, mate. I've seen them.
The coloured ones, do you know who it is that makes them? It's not Casio that make them.
No.
It's IFL Watches.
Oh, is it?
Yeah, so they take them aftermarket. Same with the Tissot ones that they sprinkle the stuff on. That. Like,
saw the advert that Nico done on that.
Sick, mate.
Cool, isn't it, man?
They're so cool, mate. Do you know what I mean? I just love stuff like that. I'm just one of those guys that's like, you'll know from me and you being on social media, having each other on social media for years, Like, I just like weird stuff. Aye. Colourful shit.
I know, I saw your car out there, bright blue. It's the same colour as this.
It's so nice, mate. I love that.
That's cool, mate.
Mate, get one of them if you like.
I know, mate. I've
been thinking about it. Like, having a kid and all that, like, you'll...
I'm going to be gutted parting ways with this M4, man. It's an absolute tool, but it's not practical, mate. It's not even practical for me.
Would you not get an M5 comp?
Nah, mate, I need like a Jeep. I need a Jeep.
A Range Rover Sport?
Something like that, mate. I don't know. I've not even really thought about it. I'm moving house, so I'm sort of invested in that. And once I'm in a house, then I know, mate, away in a house and a new car. It's fucking nuts, mate. Life's changed. Fucking nuts, mate. I'll swap you, mate, for the
M4.
You can take the M4, mate.
So you'll have been, I imagine, because you're working in a luxury industry, right? And see, for me, I don't really see it with what I do, right? I work with people who have high net worths, not normally notable people as such, a few people that you would know of, but not like famous people or anything, right? And the stuff that we buy in terms of property is normally slightly cheaper stuff, but in large volumes. Yeah. Your transaction is still a lot, but it's not like $1 million listings, right? But you focus primarily on the higher end luxury stuff, right? So I can imagine you've got mad phone numbers in there or managers for people or whatever, right? Is there one situation or like one specific transaction with a watch or with a specific person that you just, is the one that pops into your head?
It's probably the most expensive one, and just for it being the most expensive, I think the most expensive one we've sold is $300,000.
What was that?
It was a Patek. I'll not say the actual model because the guy could get caught. It was a Nautilus, rose gold Nautilus. Absolute belter, mate. Probably the best watch I've ever had done. But just because of the fact that it was so much, mate, like we had to basically go to the bank and tell them this is coming into our account because it's such a high value. So probably that's the one that stands out in my head, was probably the boy that bought that at $300,000. But there was trying to get it for him and all that. It took ages.
That's what I was going to say, because I imagine finding the buyer is so much easier than finding the watch. Something like that.
Yeah, that one was actually no as bad. We've had some other ones that have taken ages and some mad stories behind them, but that one, just for it being the most expensive one, I would probably say that. Like, anytime I think of what you said, it's the most expensive one, $300,000. That was, the guy was brand new as well. He was such a nice guy. Like, a lot of people we get, they want the watch and they want it now. Like, and we need to kind of rush it and time to get this watch and that. But this guy was spot on. Like, we just said to him, like, this will take a bit of time and stuff. So he gave us all the time we needed, and he actually sent us the money. This is how business is. We've built up to a level that we're kind of trusted now. Like, this boy, we didn't even put our money up. This boy sent us the $300,000, and then we went and got the watch. So it wasn't as if we were going and putting out the $300,000 to buy the watch and then him maybe liking it.
Uh-huh.
He sent us it.
He knew what he wanted.
He sent us the money and he said, just go and get us it. We'd only dealt with this boy once before, so he trusted us. Like, he met us, he trusted us, gave us the money. I think it was 2 weeks or something we took to go and get it.
That's really.
And then he got it, and deal was done. But just because it was such high value, we had to get approval for the bank and all that sort of stuff, mate. It's when you get that sort of like high transactions, you'll know yourself with property. Like, the banks are a bit weird with money coming in and out your bank, so we had to. I had to do all the checks and all that sort of stuff, mate. It's mental.
That's
crazy.
That's mad. And do you know what the thing is, right? The thing that I always find in terms of like customer value is that, see, that guy's buying a $300,000 watch. That's not his first watch.
No, mate.
Right?
He's got a mad
collection. So see him, he already knows what he wants.
Yeah.
He's probably already paid that kind of money, similar money for other pieces.
Yeah.
His collection is probably worth a lot more than $300,000. So see when, like, I had my first clients originally years ago, there would be guys that have a spare $30,000 or $40,000. Yeah. That one buy to let you're getting them is using every penny of their savings. So when you go, by the way, we've discovered now a window needs changed.
I don't have the money to do it.
I didn't know that. And is the insurance going to come to it? No, it's not. Oh my God, what am I made? Do you get what I mean? Yeah. But now when you're in a position with your clients being generally of a higher net worth, and they're like, oh, you can only get me 6 flats, $100,000. That's terrible. Can you not get 10? Do you get what I'm saying? They're the ones that pay the fees the fastest. They do everything much.
This guy was just pure smooth. Like, he just trusted it 100%. Like, he just went, there's the money, go and find me the watch, take your time, just get the right one. So we ended up getting the right one. I'm one, blah, 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 2022. And came back to him and he was like, perfect, that's it. It was just easy. You get a lot of clients that are kind of a bit, they need everything perfect. This guy was just, you just go and do your thing, come back to me when you've got the watch, we got the watch and it was all done. But maybe we've sold to some people that have got like mega high net worths, like in the millions. I don't think we've ever dealt with a billionaire before, but certainly multi-millionaires. But some mental clients we've got out there.
See, with stuff like that, right? And obviously, this is one thing that I always say. See some of the like ultra-rich people you get. Ultra-rich people who are very well-known.
Yeah.
Ultra-rich people who aren't. But I'm always cautious, and especially because something happened last year and I was in a casino in Glasgow and a guy tried to like glass me, basically, right? And
Glasgow, if you're not.
He's mad, mate. I swiveled at a belt, I cracked him, mate, and broke his nose. It was an absolute belt. But so if you're watching this, then fuck. But see, stuff like that. And it was just like someone going, you're that guy for TikTok. I'm a nobody in the grand scheme of the world, right? Do you get what I mean? I get decent views online for my size of account, but I'm nobody, right? And it made me think, like, whoa, imagine how famous people are actually famous, but super high net worth people need to move and you're constantly looking over your shoulder and stuff, right? So what is the logistical process of moving a 300k watch? Because I can't imagine it's you with your Frenchie in the front seat of the M4 with the patting box sitting there, right? What kind of, has there ever been any situation where you've had to have security or like, I don't know, one of the Loomis vans or something?
We've used sort of Malcamet, a big security company. If we're ever getting watches over $100,000 value, they deal with it for us. They take a fee and they get it from where it is. We tell them where to pick it up from, and I'm pretty sure it's a secure van that just comes up with it.
Yeah.
But they are like, if we're ever dealing with it over $100,000, they're the people that we go to. You pay an expensive fee, but mate, I wouldn't risk putting myself in any situation that something would happen, if you know what I mean. You're always just best, just especially if you're dealing with that sort of caliber of money, like you're as well just paying the extra bit, knowing that it's definitely going to come and stuff like that, mate. So it's
obviously now you're more experienced, right? I don't know. I mean, it could happen last week. It could happen at the start. It could happen in the future. Obviously, touch hairy wood, it doesn't. Has there ever been a situation where someone's got in touch with you to buy a watch and you're on the way and something just doesn't fit? Have you ever been in a situation where you thought, here, this could be trouble for me, I could get robbed, or
mate, I always,
sometimes I'll be driving in my car and that, right? People will be behind me and I'll move and then they'll move and then I'm like, why is this person following me?
There's always that element. Like, I think my dad and my uncle have been through it all as well. Like, they've been in the jewellery trade all the years, they've sort of cemented it in me that there's always a risk factor in being in this industry. Like, you're kind of going to be a target and stuff, but I tend not to put myself in situations that anyone can ever do that. You know what I mean? Like, there always is in the back of your head, but it's sort of, that's just different ways you can avoid it, like getting the secure vans and all that sort of stuff. Like, there has been some deals I've went and met people and blah, blah, you don't know them and such. Like, would always sort of bring somebody with me or something like that. But I would always, I think my dad and my uncle have always put it through me that, again, like they're the mentors, like they're there to tell me not to do that and stuff because they've done it,
yeah,
and they've maybe had trouble and stuff like that, so they're always there to tell me like, don't do that, do it this way, just be safer and all that. So it's good to have them.
Something I've seen online, because I didn't really, to be honest, I liked watches before I started watching content about watches. Now, obviously, because Nico's stuff and I can't remember the other guy, luxury timepiece trading or something,
Anthony.
Yeah, he's Robin Garth or whatever.
Right.
I like watching those guys. You know who I especially like watching? See, Kerry the Diamond Queen, Moses the Jeweler, and all that.
Oh, in the Diamond District, in New York.
So I love watching them. They're class, right? But the YouTube stuff I love watching. And if I like watching shit that's got drama, right? So if I see a video that's like reacting to the top 10 watches from Baselworld, I'm like, I don't give a fuck about that. When I see one like confronting scammer, I'm like,
that's the entertainment behind it, isn't it? But
it's so good.
It's in Glasgow, you can't really do that. Like, they're in a diamond district where I've been down in Hatton Garden in the arcade before, and it's kind of like that. It's all traders arguing with each other and stuff over 50 quid and stuff like that. But in Glasgow,
you save a big amount of money. If I walked in there, say you had a black sub, like, I don't like black subs, right? But let's just say you had one, and you were saying, Richard, I can sell you a black sub for this. Me, as somebody who doesn't really know anything about jewellery, I'm a great negotiator and salesperson, I think, right? would I go down there and it wouldn't be worth me going there? Or how does it work?
I don't know. There's certain rules of watches and watch dealers and that, like, see like on the chats and stuff. You need to follow these rules. You can't really...
Illuminati.
It's weird, mate. But it's good because it's secure. Like, you can't really go and fuck some other person's deal. Like, see another dealer, you can't really go and shop them and you can't steal other people's deals. I don't know how it works in the arcade because they're all, like, on each other. They're all there, so... I think it's a bit different than there, but like on the chats and stuff, there is rules and stuff you need to follow. Like, if you call the watch, you need to buy it. See, even if your client pulls out,
you need to honour that
and you need to buy it. Like, there's loads of sort of set rules and stuff, but it's good because you get a lot of people who, if that person pulled out, then they're not wanting that watch. Yeah. You've already sold it to them, so it is good in that sense. Like, people are pretty stand by their word on these chats and stuff, so it's more secure like that. Like, you don't pay like a membership fee. You just need to be a well-known dealer. You need to be vouched by people as well. Uh-huh. See if a deal was to go wrong and stuff, you need to have people on that chat. They'll vouch for you and pay your side if you have to fuck up. So it is pretty, like,
that's mad.
It's weird, isn't it? I bet a lot of people didn't know that, but like, there are set rules
in society.
And it must
be quite hard to break into that.
It's hard, mate, because you need to see what we done at the very start when we're sort of dealing with trade people. Like, it's all through WhatsApp and that, but what we found was, see if we go and meet these people, see if we're buying watch off them, instead of getting them to post up and blah, 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 we'll go down, we'll take less money on the profit, but we'll go down and meet them, talk to them face to face, and that's how we sort of built up trust with a lot of the dealers. Whereas now in the UK, we'll probably have every dealer will send watches to us without payment, and then we'll pay them like when we receive the watch and check it and stuff. Uh-huh. Whereas it's quite a big thing. If you're sending a 50-gram watch to somebody, like, and they've not paid, then
I couldn't imagine doing that.
It's weird, but that's what's good about it. It's all trustworthy. Like,
mm-hmm.
But if I was to then take that watch and not pay them, three people that vouch for me then need to pay them. So that's what it's sort of,
yeah.
There's like a circle around it,
right? Because I've been in this situation before. Like, one of my mates. It's happening now, the other way about. One of my mates bought a car years ago and like credit wasn't excellent, and the guy at the garage who I knew was like, oh, I'll do the finance through the garage just with my own money. He was like, but I need you to stand on it to me. He's like, if you miss a payment, I need you to pay it.
Yeah.
I was like, all right, okay. And then now it's spun about because I've not been using my Rolls Royce, right? It's just been sitting there doing nothing. So I said to my mate, I'm going to get short of that. And he was like, oh, I know someone who wants it, but they'll pay a little bit more and they'll tick it off you. And I was like, well, I stood on my mate's car, so you need to stand on this. And I think the argument now is like, it's a bit of a price difference. Do you know what I mean? I don't care, you need to, mate. Do you know what I mean? Imagine I was standing there and seeing someone drive past in my roller and they're like 2 months behind.
How was that? I'd be like, did you like it?
It's an excellent car. Mate, I didn't get it because I wanted it. This is the thing that
was just a goal.
No, mate. No. Oh, mate, see if this sounds terrible, right?
I've got a goal for a car, but I need to get to that level. I'm not at that level.
What is it?
GT3 RS. I need that car, mate.
Gary, did you hear the car?
Don't tell me you've bought that.
Remember where we were a couple of weeks ago?
Mate, that's my dream car, mate. I would take that over Lambo or Eton, mate. Euros, a GT3 RS, mate. I love them.
They offered me a Lizard Green one.
Oh, mate.
2017 Lizard Green PDK for $170,000.
With mega money, mate.
So,
not quite there yet.
Well, this is my three choices just now, right? For the end of the year, because I wanted it. We've got this massive event coming up. It's going to be amazing. If you're watching this Financial Freedom Summit link down below, grab your tickets. It's going to be fucking excellent. But my goal for the end of the year is the Rolls Royce is going to go, right? Yeah. See my AMG GT?
Yeah.
I had done so much work to that it was unsellable.
Aye.
I cut the cat out. It was 745 brake, right?
I remember hearing that.
So much done to it, right? So it was impossible to sell. And I was trying to sell it for ages and it just sat doing nothing, mate. Literally sat in my drive doing nothing. I didn't even want to drive it. I was sick of it. A guy like clipped the back of it in a transit in the Clyde Tunnel and spun me out.
I remember you telling me.
And I scat myself, and I just didn't feel comfortable driving after that. And eventually I found a guy with a massive car collection and we managed to do a deal. He got the GT, I got the roller. Some other stuff. So that was how we done it. But for me, just now, the end of the year, I'm going to get short of the McLaren and either want a GT3 RS, 720S, or an 812 Superfast. But the 812 is the fastest.
GT3.
Mate, would you take a manual on a PDK?
A manual.
Aye. Just want to be slower, mate.
I know, mate.
Slow, raw, innit?
You're driving it, like you can. I don't know. See, to be honest, I'm not in a situation where I can choose that, mate. I'm just taking whatever's given to me.
Well, mate, an M4 comms a fucking egg.
Mate, it's fast, mate. It's good, mate. But it's life's changed now, mate. I need a Kia.
I need
some big fucking soccer mum car.
I would say the X3M's excellent.
You like it, eh?
Oh, mate, it'd be perfect.
Rapid, but isn't it?
Fast. 515 brakes.
Is it? That's faster than M4.
Still.
I think my M4's 510 or something.
Mate. Yeah. So obviously, like I seen there with like the fucking timepiece trade and all that. I watched one the other day and it's like, four boys came in speaking some random language, trying to sell a fake. Just by chance, one of the boys in the office could speak the language.
Yeah.
Have you ever had a situation where, like, I don't know, somebody's trying to do you through PayPal, try to like do like a chargeback?
I had a chargeback. That was a fucking nightmare. Honestly, really? God, mate, it's put me off even taking card payments now, mate.
Really?
That was a fucking nightmare. 30 grand, mate. Just get wiped out of account, like. It didn't even say minus 30 grand. It just vanished. And I'm like, what the fuck? And it was a boy done a chargeback, mate. I'm not going to say too much in there, but I mean, it was a fucking nightmare trying to get it back. Wow. Trying to get our money back for a boy that scammed us.
Did you manage to get it back?
Got it all back, mate. Got it all sorted. But what he did, that was like 6 weeks it took doing investigations and all that. And then the bank was sort of siding with him for a bit. And I'm like, what?
And he had the watch, though.
He had the watch. Oh, I know, mate. But they let it came into our bank and all that, like it was
an. Surely if they were in store, it would all be on CCTV.
I never asked for it, but like I had to gather everything, prove my case. I'm like, no, you should be coming to me. If you've got a problem, then you need to be coming to me and finding out what happened. But mate, it's put me off even taking cards.
There's a company. It's owned by Grant Cardone's brother, Gary Cardone, called Chargebacks 911, and they specialise in fighting chargebacks.
Very nice. Aye, that was nuts, mate, honestly. Like,
in case that ever happened.
Aye, mate, good to know that. But aye, mate, to be honest, I don't really need to take credit cards, if I'm honest, mate. Like, it's not, I kind of done it just for.
Different if it's somebody I'm really good rapport.
Aye.
I don't imagine it was one of your mates that would do something.
It was just a random guy. But like, we checked his ID, everything, like, but
checked out.
He ended up doing a chargeback on us.
Have you ever been stung with a fake watch?
No,
have you got an eye for it? Because I know that some of them you could fool.
At the very start, I wasn't any watch that would come in. We get jewelers, all the jewelers, and that look at the back of them. My business partner, like I would say, send photos to him and tell me right away. Because I wouldn't know. Like at the start, I was quite clueless.
Sometimes people have been a victim of getting fucked over, and then they think they're coming to. Oh, Jenga's mostly people are just chancing it.
There's sort of a couple of questions you ask them, like, "Oh, where did you get the watch from? My granddad gave it when he died," and you're like, "Right, okay."
It's a pure 2022 bluesy. Where's your cancer
die? There's a couple of things you can kind of ask them, and you just sort of like assess the situation. Like, you can see if you're twitching and all that sort of stuff, mate. Like, because in our shop, there's about 10 cameras on you, like, and people know there's 10 cameras on them. So,
and do you see them looking about the cameras?
Aye. Like, I'm in the back and I can see people coming in and everything, mate. So, like, we're a jeweler's, like, it needs to be like that. Like, your security system's mental. So, I think there's maybe been one person who I would probably say didn't know. The rest, I wouldn't say we've had
like gutted, like upset.
Aye, like genuinely, like, oh fuck, like, because he's spent like a good bit of money on it and it wasn't a fake. So there's a thing called a Frankenstein.
Yeah, so I've heard of that.
It's a real watch with fake movement. So whoever's heard it before is taking out the movement, sold the real parts, put a fake movement in, and a real outer case watch. So it was that.
Why would they do that? Is there like money in doing that?
Well, you can take the real part out of it and sell them for high money. Like real Rolex parts go for mega money. So there was that. They've had a couple of people come in. We bought a fake off a trader in London that we were sourcing it in. It was a Daytona APH style, an absolute belt, 18 grand or something, mate. One of my favorite watches, like one of the discontinued Daytona models, and we bought it and it came in and I was like, doesn't feel right, like the weight didn't feel right, and I'm like, maybe it was just older, I don't know. And then my business partner came in and looked at it and went, that's not right. And then we opened up the back of it. But to be fair, with trade watches, we don't really open up the back because it's pretty.
You trust to get in. Trust the like what you're saying.
Aye. So
stuff like,
we sort of we looked at the movement. It wasn't right again. It was a Frankenstein, so fake movement. And we went back to him and said, you need to sort this, mate. Like, we've lost the deal, so you need to pay off part of the. Or profit for the deal, or replace the watch. He didn't really fancy it, so we then put it on the chat, and let everyone else deal with it. And then he ends up getting removed for all the chats and stuff. So I don't even know what's happening with him.
And did you get your...
Aye, we got the money back and all that, mate, because, like, he was forced to then give us our money and we send the watch to him. But, aye, like, you wouldn't think that with a trader, but aye, that happened, mate.
That was
this year, mate. We don't get often people coming in with fakes, like, it's no something that happens often, but we are prepared if somebody was to come in. All the sort of steps are there. I've got the jewellers to look at the back yet. I've got myself, and then we've got my business partner as well, so it's...
Yeah, you've got a lot of barriers.
There's barriers to get past this.
Is it true that if you go to, like, an AD with one, they'll say they're taking it in the back to look at it and they drill a hole through it? Is that true?
I heard that, nah.
This must be an...
I don't like Rolex. I don't like the ADs, so I'm just going to tell everyone that's true. I don't like them. They don't like me either, so if any ADs are watching this...
Fuck you. But I got told that, like, if you go in, say the guy that was gutted that gets stung or something, like, oh, I'm looking to sell this, or blah, 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 or get it serviced or something, they'd be like, aye, 2 minutes, we'll go get someone in the back to open it, and then they bring it out with, like, a hole drilled through it if it's a fake.
Oh, if it's a fake? Yeah. Mate, I don't know about that, but they will come out and tell you, no, we're not touching this, if this is a fake. Or if you have a fake dial or anything on
Apple
that watch,
market.
Anything that's aftermarket at all, like, that fucks are wanted, they will not
touch it. On it, they won't touch it?
Aye, they won't touch it, mate. Oh. Not at all, mate.
What's your thoughts on Bustines and that?
What a shite, mate.
You hate them?
Yeah. Like, to be fair, like I'm in a... been grown up in the diamond trade. Like, I love diamonds.
The date just?
I've had one of them, innit?
It was the Arabic diamond.
That was for a football player, mate.
That was a belt.
So we got that made. Like, we actually customised that. So we've got a factory out in Thailand. We got the watch in, customised the full thing. He picked up all the diamonds. We supplied the diamonds, sent it over to Thailand. They got customised. We came back to us, and it was an absolute belter. Like, the work involved in it is amazing. Like, I do appreciate the jewellery part of it, but for me, if you're planning on keeping that watch forever, you want to die with that watch on.
Good on you.
If you're in your coffin with your diamond set Rolex on, then fair play to you. That's amazing. Like, it's cool. But when you come to sell that, see if you're in trouble and you come to sell that watch, mate, you're fucked. Not a lot of dealers will buy bust downs, or if they do, they'll want it mega cheap because it's really hard to sell.
The factory sets are so dear, aren't they?
Yeah.
What is the word Rolex use for factory set diamonds? It's like, we'll say it in description. What is it?
Is it pavé?
No,
that's
no.
A type of diamond set.
Nico was talking about it in a video, and he was saying, like, it would say, like, marvelous or some word.
Is it?
Say that in, like, a description thing. And it just means, like, if you've not got photos and you're reading through, you can just tell, oh, that's one with diamonds.
Ah, right, okay. Like, no, I don't even know that. I know they say pavé on it, but that's just a type of diamond setting. But mate, some of the factory ones are mental, mate. They use, like, the mega good quality diamonds as well. I think it's VVS or something they use, but it's mega. Mega expensive, mate.
But I guess when you're playing in that kind of world, like, it
wouldn't
affect you.
Rolex can charge whatever they want, and everyone just jumps on it. It's nuts. The market inside of Rolex is just amazing.
Aye, they've...
Non-profit company as well.
Is it true that Rolex and Tudor are the same?
Aye, it's the same company, so it's Rolex that make Tudors. Like, they own the sister company.
And the movements and all that the same?
Nah, I don't think they'll be the same movements. They'll be the same factory that builds them. But we're two separate. You've got your Rolex movements in your shoes. I'll need to look up on that. Actually, I don't actually know myself, but just talking, I think it'll be a different...
Aye.
So, Tudors are nice, mate. I like them. Don't sell a lot of them, but I think they're good watches as well. So you were saying somebody that's starting out. Mm-hmm. I like Tudors, mate. Just because probably they are built the same as Rolex, or built by Rolex, so you know they're going to be
good. Nice as well.
I think they're nice, mate. It's a good start out watch. Like, if you want to build your way up, tag Tudor, Rolex... blah, 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 Richard Neal.
It's funny, mate, because see, when you talk about a startle watch, right? Like, I was watching some videos the other day.
One of those wee Casios with a fucking calculator on them,
aye. They were interviewing this young boy, and it goes to show how out of touch people are sometimes. I like people aspiring for the best things in life, right? And the guy goes to this young lad in the street, what would be your ideal watch, like your ideal first watch? And he goes, oh, I think a GMT Master's a good starter watch. And I'm like, no, like, a Casio's a starter watch.
Grand watch.
You know what I mean? He's saying that because he's watching rappers RMs and AP.
You need to start like, off.
That's not starter.
Not everyone's got that sort of money to fire down a watch at the start, mate. Like, I honestly think Tag is where you should start. If you are wanting to collect watches, Tag, Tudor, Rolex. If you can jump one, then buy...
The first watch I ever bought was a Rolex.
Was it?
Well,
you're doing all right, but
I was never into watches when I was a wee guy. I never really wore a watch. My dad wasn't into watches. My grandpa's had the same Jaguar watch.
Jaguar watch?
Since...
Fucking hell.
Since before I was born. He's had it forever. Goes and gets wee bits changed and that's all he wears, right? And this is how fucking hilarious this is, right? You know when you see in New York those Invicta shops, those watches? Yeah, the Invicta, whatever it's called. And it's like, buy two watches, get four. So you get some shite watches like that in the world, right? So I remember getting a Ben Sherman set.
Oh, Ben Sherman.
I'm talking
to you. And the T-shirts.
See, when I was like 7 or 8. I might have been a wee bit older. I wasn't in secondary school or anything, right? And this is how you know the watch must have been terrible, right? Because it was like, I got boxers. But it was like, no boxers that were tight. Mind, did you wear loose boxers?
Aye.
Did you wear loose boxers as well, Gary?
I still wear loose, right?
But you can't see them anymore.
No.
They were pure horrible to wear, right? So I got these like tartan Ben Sherman boxers. I had a T-shirt in it. I had a wee aftershave. It came with a free watch.
I remember Ben Sherman, man. That's crazy.
So it came with a free watch. But it was like for an adult, mate.
He's not trying to sell
it. Okay, so it's a fucking vintage.
How many diamonds said?
But I've got very small wrists, right? And I've put it on. It's pure hanging down here. And I'm like, what the fuck is that? And it sat in a jar. I think it's still in my mom and dad's house, maybe, right?
He's an old dad.
That would be a hilarious video, mate, honestly. So that was like my first watch that I'd had. And then my sister bought me a gold Casio, which I've still got. I love. Love that wee watch. And it's so handy. So alarms on.
Mate, they're mega. You see everyone with those watches?
Yeah, they're class, mate. And then I was sitting in Yo Sushi in Silverburn. Me and my mate James. And I was just sitting eating. And I walked past Chisholm Hunter. Mate, I was wearing the worst outfit ever. I had a black hoodie on like this, with brown Alessi trackies on, a pair of like black 95s. I think I'd been at like the driving range or something. And then stopped there on the way back for the mirrors. And I went, oh, let's look at the Rolexes. And I was looking about. And the first one I got was, you see the date just you took the light? Right, the wee blue face, the little diamond numbers, right? And I was looking, it just kind of sparkled at me. I thought, well, that's quite nice. And I went and said to the woman in there, I says, can I just have a look at that? And I felt quite out of place. And I was probably doing about 10k a month at that point, right? But I felt like, well, I shouldn't really be in here. No offence, Chisholm Hunter's not exactly the fucking be-all, end-all of jewellers, right? But I was like, oh my God. And I was like, I didn't know if they'd maybe, nobody even let you hold it, right? But she's like, look at that. And I clicked on and all that. And I'm like, wow, it's lovely and all that. And she goes like that to me. Oh, you know, we do 0% finance. And that got my back up a little bit. I was like, I just was saying it to genuinely be nice, because I was also dressed like a JK, right? So I was like, so how much is it? And she's like, oh, it's like, £5,150 or something like that. And she's like, it's got the box and the papers. And I'm like, box and papers? What's that? Like, you know what I mean? I was like, what's box and papers, mate? Yeah. So of course it's got a box or whatever, right? And I was just like, I'll have it.
Did you buy it?
Aye. And she was like, really? I mean, I'd been in 5 minutes. And I was like, yeah, I'll have it. She's like, all right, okay, 2 minutes. And then they measured my wrist with the hang, went and took links out for me.
Mate,
I had it on my wrist. And mate, I was just sitting that whole time like, I couldn't believe it, mate. And I went home and I was still staying with my mum and dad's bit, right, at that point. And I went in and I'm like, look at that. And my mum and dad, one time on holiday, is hilarious. My mum loves negotiating with like market sellers and all that. She's the quietest woman ever. She's never worked in sales. She works for the Scottish government, mate. But see, when it comes to buying like random shit at markets and all that,
is that about half her?
She loves
it. That's my mum.
So my mum, for a laugh, bought, just for the love of the negotiation, the worst fake Rolex you've ever seen. Like, it wasn't even a mod. It looked at the Ben Sherman watch, mate. And it, like, the Rolex was all like, and really, she must have paid, see if she paid more than £5 for it, I'd be amazed. But she'd done it flat and she came home, she's like, I got you a gift. And I've still got that in the house, mate. I'm saying,
yeah.
It's fucking hilarious. And I went home and I was looking, and my dad just kind of confused. And I was like, no, it's real, it's mine. What the fuck? But that was my
first one. Mate, I don't get that. See, like, people that turn their nose up to people that have come in and full trackies and that. Like, I've had people come in, they're with mega money and with full grey trackies on, then I've spent £100,000 on a watch, mate. Like, I wear trackies all day and muck, mate. I don't get people like that, but you do get that a lot in the arcades. See, if you're, I think that's an old school jewellers thing, but like, that's their mentality, is if you're don't look right, then you shouldn't be wearing it.
Do you know what's funny, mate? I was in the arcade once
And I'm not liking that arcade.
Nah, I can imagine, not to be fair. And I was walking through and I was just looking at stuff. Do you know the only thing I've ever bought in the arcade is the Casio watches?
Yeah.
Those are the ones.
They sell them?
The Casio. I can't mind what one it is. H. Samuels. I can't mind. It's like a wee jeweler. They don't sell it expensive or whatever. But I was looking through and walking through and I've got this full limited edition gold Stone Island set. Gold trousers, gold overshirt, gold jacket with like a puffer liner in it, right? And I was wearing that gold jacket and it's like, if you know Stone Island stuff and you've seen that, even if it's not your taste, you go, oh, fuck, that's a rare jacket, right? And I've got that on and I'm walking through the arcade and it was just me and one of those fucking weird hat-wearing fucking freaks at the front started like walking right? But then, mate, I've stopped and I've had a thought about another watch shop down there and I started walking back and he goes to me, this is a one-way. And I was like, I went, what? Is it a one-way?
I went,
mate, I'm walking back. Nah, you need to walk out and back around, right?
That's just happening.
Like, what the hell? And then, this is the weirdest thing ever, because you know the rapper boy, Bems?
I
done that shot on the wing.
I've spoke to him on Instagram before, actually.
Mate, Bems used to work in the arcade.
Did he?
I've never met him before. Right. And this made so sound, right? I've never met him at this point. He has Hunters of Stone Island stuff and all that. Mate, he's sitting at a table with a woman discussing a ring. And he went, 2 minutes and he's came out and went, bro, that jacket, mate, like, just, I've never met him before, we didn't follow each other and all that, but that jacket's sick. And see him coming out and saying that made the mad fucking hat wearing freak go away. And then I was like,
that's mental. Well, I didn't know he worked in the arcade.
He worked in the arcade, mate. Yeah.
That's mental. I've spoken to him a couple of times on Instagram and he seems a brand new guy. Nice, he's a good rapper as well.
Aye, he'll do
good with music. Yep. Well, he's a good Celtic fan as well.
Good Celtic fan. Is there such a thing, guys? Is there such a thing?
Wait, my business partner is a staunch Rangers fan, so it works well for us. Well, maybe not this Sunday, but...
Oh, my goodness. I don't know, mate. I'm just happy we got top six, mate. Well,
you beat us.
We did. We're the only ones to beat you domestically, I believe.
Aye.
Oh, actually, are we?
Aye, Rangers have no beat us now.
No, that was last season. Beat you.
Aye. I've some money though.
You're on some run.
I know, mate.
Fucking mental.
I better keep up this Sunday, man.
What is your maddest watch story in terms of? Obviously, we've heard the most expensive. Not has there ever been one like Ryan? It's 11 o'clock now. I'm wanting this watch by 3 in Portugal. Can you do it?
Mate,
you ever been put under any insane pressure that's just been...
Mate, every day, everyone wants to watch the next day. Like, every single day. But there's one, and it was a football player, who, he didn't really put us under pressure as such. Like, he wanted the watch, we got him the watch, and it just happened so fast. Like, flew us out to Poznan. He played for, like, Poznan. Flew us out to Poznan.
They've got a real... militant support.
Honestly, like, I've got videos of, like, we were in the players' lounge waiting for him because we were going to get him after the game. But their fans are fucking nuts.
Proper ultras, like maniacs.
Oh, mate, like, they had, and so we were in the players' lounge, and then that's the ultra section, the full, like, stand. They had the other team's flags and scarves all put out the full size of the stand. And then they had flares and just lit the full thing on fire, mate. All the flags and all the... I'm sitting going, what the fuck, man? This shit's all over Celtic Rangers, man. This is nuts.
That's
the proper insane fans, mate. But went over and he sorted us out, mate. The boy's absolutely brand new. What a gentleman. And went down to players' lounge. They came out after the game. They won the game. And he came out, got to meet all the players, showed them the watch and that. And then they all started following us on Insta, all the, like, Poznan players. So I think I've got half the, like, Poznan team. On Insta.
Class.
But it was class, mate. That was really good. I enjoyed that. It wasn't really such like a stress, but that was the most enjoyable one because I like football myself, so it was good to go out there and see, like, I would never go out to a Poland game, mate, but that was wild. It was proper.
Poland's a cool place, mate. I've only been once. I liked it.
I'd like to go Poznan, maybe. I'd like to go elsewhere, like Krakow or something.
Yeah, that's where I went, mate.
But it's just something I would have never done, but it just went quite fast, actually. We got him the watch, and then I wasn't sure if I was going to post out or if he was coming back, and he just said, do you want to come out to the game on Saturday? I was like, yes.
That's
so, like, that's the perks of the job.
They pay all your travel.
Aye, they basically paid everything now.
No. Wow. That's class.
But it's cool, but because he could have got that watch in Poland, whereas he took the time to come to me. Again, because he trusted me, like, we'd been talking for a while, and he kind of trusted us, so he, like, flew us out and paid the hotel, paid the flight, and got us all sorted in the players' lounge.
I think when you're buying something that's high value, What is the difference? Even now,
I like meeting people. Like, see, before this, like, I wouldn't have done this. Like, you probably knew. Like,
I
was dead secretive. I didn't want my face involved in it. And then I sort of realised, like,
you're doing a lot more on YouTube.
So we've got the YouTube and all that, and I've sort of realised. See, with people, like, the trust value in this sort of game. So see if they see you putting your face out and everything. There's more trust involved in it. So that's why I've sort of changed my thinking. I've done it more for security reason, but now I've sort of realised, like, to get more business than that, you really do need to put your face out. You know yourself, mate. Like, you do it very, very often. So
it's one of those things, mate. Like, it's not that you have to do it. It depends on what you're looking to achieve. The thing I always say is, look at, say, Zara, for example, right? Do you know who owns Zara?
No.
It's a guy called Amancio Ortega, right? I think he's still in the top 10 richest men in the world, but I think he was like number 3 or something. Now he's at like maybe 8 or 9, right? So, Spanish guy. He's done one public interview since the 80s. He could walk into a Zara shop and people be like, what size are you, mate? Do you get what I mean? Nobody knows who he is. He's a multi-billionaire, right? And he can...
That's the ideal scenario, but it doesn't often happen like that.
Right? So, and here I am still talking about him in here. So people still know who he is, right? But then you've got, say, Elon Musk, for example. And forget the fact that the net worths are different, right? Because sometimes Carlos Slim Hilo is the richest man in the world. He doesn't really put himself out there and stuff like that, right? But Elon Musk, who has more followers online? Elon Musk or Tesla on Instagram?
It's got to be Elon Musk.
Right? And what that gives him is a unique opportunity that any business he touches or is involved
in.
Think about the Dogecoin thing.
He tweeted something, it went mental, didn't it?
Do you know, he has such power in his personal brand, so that, say you're scrolling down, you see two articles, and one article is, Amancio Ortega makes large investment at such and such, you'll probably scroll past that, right? If it's like, Elon Musk invested in the same company, what's going to get more clicks?
Mate, weird you say that, because, like, I don't particularly, I have no, like, interest in, well, not interest, but, like, I have no view on Elon Musk, but, see, whenever it pops up on Twitter, whenever headlines pop up, I always stop to read it.
Mate,
it's weird. I don't know if it's...
I think he's great.
He is, mate. Like, I like the fact he just gets out there. Like, see, he does all the podcasts. I've seen the one he done with the BBC presenter.
Oh, slaughter.
I felt...
Slaughter.
I actually felt bad for that BBC presenter. I'm like, oh, just shut up, mate. Just be quiet. He's going to rinse you.
He got absolutely...
He gets himself out, mate. And that's why... That's what... Well, I've sort of learned now that with this sort of game, you do need to kind of get yourself out there a bit. You need to build up trust with people and stuff like that. And that's why I'm sort of doing stuff like this. So people can see my face and that they trust you a bit more, because you are dealing and you're providing them a service that they're paying a lot of money for. People spend their full year's wages and stuff on big watches. So you want to be involved in it and just a bit trustworthy. So.
I've got a rule on my own personal social media, different from business accounts, because I don't manage them.
Yeah.
Like the Yes account and all that stuff. I only manage really my personal Instagram.
Yeah.
Even LinkedIn and stuff, I don't do that much on. But Instagram, I'm the only person with access. And I have a rule that if someone messages me, I don't care if they have 100k followers, right?
Yeah.
If they have no profile photo and it's a private account, I will never respond.
Oh,
never respond.
Story.
Have you got a mad?
Mate.
I just never do it, mate. Or see someone who has a public account. Well, say you mesh me off Glasgow Watch Co.
Yeah.
But now you can see your face because you're putting your views up and stuff. See before, and Glasgow Watch Co. and see your 20 photos of watches mesh me. Hey, bro, what's the script to invest in with you and blah, blah, blah. I would just say, hey, mate, thanks a lot for getting in touch. Mesh me off your personal profile. We can chat. I'd never, if I can't see someone's face, I'm not, you're not getting
in touch with me. Funny you say that, man. Like, I won't say his name, but a weird story. A profile with, like, we were the same. See, like, we get a lot of tire kickers in the game, mate. Like, people that message you wanting a watch, they're not really wanting a watch, they don't have the money for the watch, blah, blah, blah. Like, there's so many time wasters in that game, but you do need to put up with a lot of people, because one time an account messaged us, one follower, and no, zero followers, and like followed like 10 people. And he was speaking, I knew he was Scottish the way he was speaking, so that MSN chat everyone does. And he messaged us, was asking for a watch, and to be fair, I kind of backheeled it a bit, and then he kept messaging. I was like, right, look, I'll go and get your price. So went and got my price, and he was like, I'll take it. And then he was like, can I get your number? I was like, aye. So I gave him my business number. No, I gave him my personal number at the time, because I was stupidly giving him my personal number at the start. And he messaged on WhatsApp, and it was a professional football player for Glasgow, a very, very high profile one, mate.
So
I went and met him, and it was him. I couldn't believe it.
Obviously, no one did you scream. I was able to share maybe he gets watches off another guy who normally works with.
But
that's mad,
mate. So
the good side or the other side?
It was on our team, but they were quite high up, mate. Very, very high profile. You'll know who it is. But it was just wild, like that, because at that time we were kind of the same. We were getting loads of messages and ones that didn't really look like they were leads. You were kicking them away. But
I know birds get stuff like that. Birds will get guys who don't want message screenshotting and they'll like message.
But this boy just messaged and then he messaged on his WhatsApp and I saw his profile picture. I'm like, that's not him. Crazy, mate.
That's mad.
And I went and met him and he's bought a couple of us now. I've got his number and he just messaged on WhatsApp that now. Crazy.
That's class.
I know, mate. So now every lead I need, so even if you've got a profile with zero on it, zero face, I'll message you back.
Mate, I'm sitting here now thinking if I missed it.
I know.
This guy texts me.
Crazy, mate. But it's weird. Like it's.
Do you know what the thing is as well? See, maybe not with you because you're at a stage where you're doing enough volume. You know your margins. You work to your margins. Yeah. That's what you do, right? But say you're a young guy just started selling watches. If someone messes you who's got a blue tick, could probably add £1,000 to the price of the watch. Or someone who is, tell us more money.
Aye.
Say you're able to sell him that for £13,000, they might go, I'll give him it for £13,500 because I know he's got money. Do you get what I'm saying?
Aye. Mate, see, be fair, me and Mark, we would get footballers and that and blue ticks that would message us and we would always try and do it cheaper for them. I know a lot of people would do it the other side where they'd put £1,000 on knowing they've got the money, but we kind of done the opposite. We would take £500,000 off it. We still make sure we earn something, no massive amounts, but we just look after them because, mate, blue ticks can do serious stuff for you on Instagram. But we would always say to them, look, we're sorting you out, can you sort us out as well? And it would work a two-way thing, and it has worked. But I do get some people will think like that, like we've got a blue tick, so they must have loads of money and put up the money on the other side. But
it's also funny how many influencers, male and female, are penniless, mate. Cunts that have 500k, 600k, 700k.
Mate,
not to get started about the fact that most of the audiences are fake and they buy followers, right? But I know, so it's like if you have got 600k and you're sitting with your boys in Dubai, right, and tagging the place because they've gave you a free bottle of fucking Smirnoff, right? And you're cutting them out and you're willing to do like a shout out for like a free t-shirt or something. Yeah. Are you playing it?
Mate, I've had influencers bashing before to do a promotion on Rolex. It's like I'll take the Rolex and then you I'll ding me on my page. I was like, nah, mate, you're all right.
I've done that, you fucking idiot. See, well, I'm done.
Mental, mate, honestly, crazy.
Anyone else try 50 healers? That's really,
I know, mate.
Out.
Aye, genuinely, like, mental, mate.
But that's hilarious.
Like, I didn't even respond, man. I just looked at it.
What kind of size of audience? Love Island people?
No, like, nah, nobody for Glasgow. It was like elsewhere, but you went on
it. Big followers?
Big followers, mate.
Yeah. But that's hilarious.
Mental, like,
someone must have said yes to that for them.
I know.
That's reasonable. They must have a pal who's a big following going, oh, you see that? I got that for free because I've done a shout out or something.
Mental, mate. I've no problem with influencers. Like, they do well. A lot of them do well. But see, going and asking for stuff, like,
that's embarrassing.
If a company sends you something, then aye, fair play. Uh-huh. But no, don't go and ask for it, man. That's just no matter anyway, mate. It's weird.
That is so bad,
mate.
Mate. And how can somebody no want to, like, kill themselves after that, by the way, with embarrassment?
I'm Rolex as well. It's not like it's not.
It's just like a bracelet.
I know, mate.
£800 bracelet. Even then, you'd be like, fuck off, you fucking idiot.
It's crazy, man.
That's made my skin crawl, mate. That's so bad.
I know.
That is so
another day if I've been a watch dealer, man. It's nuts. It's crazy. Something happens every day, mate. It's wild.
What's next for Glasgow Watch Co? Where do you? I know you want to see about the highest highs. But
aye.
What's the next 12 months look like for you guys?
So we've just about signed the heads of terms on a new showroom.
Amazing.
On Ingram Street. It's going to be more like a sort of penthouse showroom where we're going to take the customers. We're never going to have
a boutique almost.
Aye, so it'll be all open plan couches, TVs, bars, and stuff like that. Because like right now we're under that bridge at Central Station and people are coming in spending big money. But we want
it smells like Blue Lagoon.
Aye, but we want to make it more like an experience. You come get champagne, you're spending the money, like enjoy your actual self, whereas now they're coming under the bridge and it's not the best place, mate, to be honest. So I've got that sorted, that's in the pipeline.
Been a few times, by the way, that I've came, like, just a handful of times that I've came to the shop, because normally you would meet me out, you'd come past my house or whatever, but there's one time, mate, that I can't remember, I think I had the Skydweller with me originally when you were taking photos of it when you saw the Skydweller, and, mate, I had it in, like, I don't know, a big, putting the box inside my pocket, mate, And see, as soon as I got to McDonald's, I was like,
aye, mate, 4 quid, isn't it? Some of the things I've seen under them, mate, is wild, mate. That's probably got to be the roughest part in Glasgow, mate.
Sucky Hall Street's getting bad, mate. Hall Street's getting
all
bad.
Round that salary is, it's, man. So we're getting it. It's good for my dad, mate. Business is class for my dad, but
they do pawn stuff as well, right?
It's like it's jewellery. It's they do well out that part, but for watches, it's no the best. Like,
yeah.
So we do, like I said, we do have quite a lot of VIP customers, and we want to try and treat everyone like a VIP that's coming in to buy watches for us. So we'll take them up. It'll be appointment only. We'll have this boutique that we're going to properly kit out. Like, everyone's going to spend good money on it. And that's the plan for the next 12 months. We'll hopefully have that, if everything goes to plan, which like Enton does these days, should maybe end of July. So, I mean, I've got the way in the way on end of July as well.
Oh, my goodness. Everything coming
up. I know, mate.
Time.
But that's the next 12 months for us, mate. Hopefully get that up and running. And just keep selling watches, mate.
Class,
that,
man.
We kind of pride ourselves in being cheaper than everyone else. Like, we don't tend to be greedy with a lot of things, so we'll just keep it like that, mate. I want to try and build the team as well. We've got a couple of our boys coming to work for us. Social media, that's going to be big for us. YouTube and stuff. So we've got some people coming in working for us full time now. So
social media is the easiest way to reach a mass audience, mate.
Instagram's done so well for us. We don't sell anything through people walking in the shop, people on our website. We don't sell anything, but Instagram's where we sell everything, mate. It's wild how much, like, mass products you can sell.
The same with, like, cars and stuff. You see, like, these different car showrooms that post, like, especially the ones that only post the price of finance. If someone posts a more that's 50 grand, people might go, 50 grand, that's mental. They post up saying, by the way, this car's £600 a month. Then people go, shit, like, I could fucking go for that. Do you know what I mean?
We did do finance on watches for a bit, but
you're not doing it anymore?
No, mate. What happened was, I think we kind of, you know, same people that have bumped you. I think this finance company bumped us a bit, mate.
Oh, really?
So they promised us, oh, blah, 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 your customers will be given, like, I think it was like 10% APR, which is all right for watches. Like, it's no the worst, it's no great, but it's all right. And then, so we took the agreement with them, and then we were, people were doing the finance agreement, and they were coming out with like 25% in it. I was like, nah, like, I'm not getting my customers to pay 25% APR. That's wild. That is nuts. I was saying to people, don't take that. Like, that's crazy. So we just patched them, mate. But I think that we were lied to a bit there, saying that they would give us, it would be 10% a customer.
Another lesson.
Yes, I know, exactly, mate. That's what business is all about. It's just about failing and then doing better at it. That's what it's all about. You'll know yourself, mate.
For sure, mate, for sure. Anything you want to shout out, anything you want to plug, we're going to leave all your links down below and stuff, so you get anything you want to...
Just if anyone wants a watch, come here. YouTube, mate, we're going to get that up and sorted, mate. So if you want to see me make an arse of it, just go on the YouTube channel, mate.
That's ultimate. Well, thank you very
thanks
much.
Thanks a lot, mate. I appreciate you having me on, mate.
Thank you. So there we have it. That's today's episode done. Ryan Mulligan from Glasgow Watch Co. If you're interested in having a look at the watches, engaging with Ryan's content, find out a little bit more about the industry and what it is he does, if you go to the description down below, you're going to find all of his social media. Like, fucking idiot. Let me try that again. You're going to find all of his social media links down below. You can connect with him, connect with the business, and I'm sure there's going to be some great watches for you to buy and have a look at as well. I know you're on the site. I know you're scrolling down, looking at the speakers, looking at what a fucking great weekend we're going to have, but still, I'm yet to see your name on the booking list. The Financial Freedom Summit is on the 10th and 11th of June. It's a short couple of weeks away. This is 2 days that you can spend with myself, BBC Dragons, Stars of the Apprentice, million plus subscriber YouTubers, all showing you different ways that you can make money, promote your business, scale a current business, and get that freedom, that time freedom, that money freedom that you've been looking for. You need to make sure that you click down below the card down here. Get your ticket for the Financial Freedom Summit. There's going to be 500 other entrepreneurs there for you to network with, all also driven to succeed. I want to make sure that I see you there, so get your ticket booked and let's catch up.